No other king could vanquish the warhorse or silence the warrior's rage while riding the lowly back of a donkey. No other king could break the dominion of darkness, the tyranny of evil, with a reign of grace and a kingdom of peace. No other king could give his life for the redemption of rebels, his wealth to welcome the outcast. Jesus is that king, the king of glory, son of the living God. Not just another king, not just another prophet, not just another teacher. He was the one the world had been waiting for, the one to deliver us from captivity, the son of David and Abraham's chosen seed. He is the goal of the Mosaic Law, Yahweh in the flesh. He is the one to establish God's reign and rule, to heal the sick, give sight to the blind, freedom to the prisoners, and proclaim good news to the poor. This Jesus was the Creator come to earth and the beginning of a new creation. He embodied the covenant, fulfilled the commandments, and reversed the curse. This Jesus is the Christ that God spoke of to the serpent, the one prefigured to Noah in the flood, the one promised to Abraham, the one guaranteed to Moses before he died, the one promised to David during his reign, the one revealed to Isaiah as a suffering servant, the one predicted through the prophets and prepared for through John the Baptist. He is the Father's Son, Savior of the world, and substitute for our sins. More loving, more holy, and more wonderfully terrifying than we ever thought possible. He is our Jesus, and there is no other king like him. He is our God, our glory, our victorious Savior. There is no other king like him. There is no other king.
He is indeed the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Welcome, everybody. We are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. All around the world, it does not matter what the situation may be, my instincts, my guts tell me that every Christian is remembering this day for what it is, the day in which we get to live again. The resurrection of Jesus stands at the very heart of Christianity. Without his resurrection, God's saving grace is null and void. Even more so, Jesus' resurrection is the optimum confirmation that Jesus is indeed who he said he is. Renowned author and theologian John Walvoord stated the following. He said, "From the standpoint of an apologetic for Christian theology, belief in Jesus Christ as the Son of God stands or falls with the question of his bodily resurrection." Likewise, in 1 Corinthians 15, 17 and 18, it says, "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are also lost." Walvoord continues by saying that the resurrection, therefore, is properly considered a proof of the person of Christ, his deity, messiahship, and the power to save from sin. The Old Testament is filled, saturated with predictions and expectations of the death and the resurrection of the Holy One of Israel. And the New Testament is filled with eyewitness accounts to the glorious event of his resurrection. In the words of theologian James Eyre, the reality of Christ's death and resurrection, as against the swoon of theories, was touched on before and needs not to be re-argued. And I'm not going to argue for it. We are going to simply assume it today. So what I want to do is that I'm not going to present arguments for the resurrection of Jesus as the historicity and the validity of this single most important event in all of Christendom. Forget Christendom. The most important event in the history of humanity that has already been established, and we consider it as such. What I want us to do is to concentrate on the implications of this, of his resurrection. And my prayer is that we will take this word and apply it to our heart where it can do the most good. Yes, the heart, not just an intellectual understanding of what the resurrection means and how it is a transforming idea for all of us, but I want it to be able to saturate the heart. And it is because only the heart can dissect a message to such a degree that it has a multiplicity of applications. This is the reason why when there are times when we are at church, and many of you have come to me and told me how a message has transformed your thinking or transformed your life in some way or fashion. And as I listen in awe, as you describe what you heard, I realize that some of what you heard is not what I said. And as many of the applications that you come up with were not even designed in what I said. But the reason why you're able to do that is because you have taken it to heart. And when a message enters into the heart, it becomes greater than the sum of its parts. And it produces more than just what was originally said. Let me give you an example. God said the words, "Let there be light." He just mentioned the words, and the sun appeared. The sun was simply there. God was never specific concerning what the sun was. We look at the scripture, and the Bible does not say that God said, "Let the sun be comprised of nitrogen and helium and hydrogen and oxygen and carbon and neon and iron, silicone, magnesium, sulfur, and whatever else is part of the sun." God never had to tell the sun specifically. Your photosphere has to have a temperature of around 10,000 degrees Fahrenheit. You never heard God actually tell the sun, your core needs to heat at around 27 million degrees Fahrenheit. All he said was, "Let there be light." And the intent for which that word came out came into fruition, even beyond what the words were said. Why? Please remember this. The intent for which a word was spoken is infinitely more complex than the word itself. The intent for which a word is spoken is infinitely more complex than the word itself. We can see this even in the natural. This is the reason why when you tell your child to go clean up his room and all he does is pick up the things from off the floor and just put them on the bed, you come in the room and you are upset. And the reason why you are upset is because the intent of the words were not followed. With my children, I guarantee that they understand the intent of my heart to a degree of maybe 98% of the time. However, they tend to want to just simply hold me to the word, to the letter, because it satisfies what they want to do. But they understand that even though I may say just clean up the kitchen, that it means the dishes, it means the floor, it means everything. And so it is with the word of God. It has more implications than just the specific word. Let me give you another example. Look at what God says about his own word in Isaiah 55:10. It says, "As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater." And let me take a break right here. Water comes down, and what it produces is not just water. It produces a whole lot more. It's just water coming down, but coming up is a whole lot more. And God continues by saying, "So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent." So sometimes When you get to the heart of things, you come to realize that things are a whole lot more complex and they accomplish a whole lot more than just what it says. This is the same thing that happens with the resurrection of Christ. Turn with me to Romans 6, 4, and I'll show you what I'm talking about. It says, "We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been freed from sin." So being baptized, which basically means being placed into, so being baptized into Christ means being placed into Christ. So we were baptized into his death means that we were placed into his death. We died with him in essence. And if we died with him, then we also resurrected with him. So his resurrection is more than just resuscitation. Something in us died with Jesus, and something in him rose for us, in us, with him. In dying for us, and in us dying in him, he took on our identity. And in rising with him, we took on his. God's work of salvation is identifying the believer with Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. This separates us from sin's power and gives us a new quality of life. And I have not even begun to talk about heaven. So the quality of life that I am talking about is not heaven, though heaven has been promised to us, but it is the here and it is the now. Look at 2 Corinthians 5:17. It says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature." He is a new creature, not he shall become a new creature. The old has gone. Not the old shall go away. The new has come. Not the new shall come, but everything is in the present tense. And it is in the present tense is because we have been resurrected with Christ right now, right here. In other words, you have been given a new identity that you have right now because the old one has died. But it is precisely this new life, this new identity that the adversary, the devil, is so keen to want to steal from you. Think about the scripture that says, "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy." And Jesus says, "But I have come that they may have life, and that life more abundantly." Some translation says life to the full. What does life to the full mean? What does life abundant actually mean? Well, I can tell you what it does not mean. It does not mean I'm surviving. It does not mean, you know, I'm here. It does not mean, I'm making it. Life abundant really means much, much, much more than just that. So if that is what you are experiencing now, I have good news for you. You can actually experience a whole lot more than just that. His resurrection accomplished much more than just returning to breathing. His resurrection accomplished more than just to give birth to the idea of an egg-laying bunny. It's a whole lot more than just that. He brought life and newness of life to everything. There are some rights, there are some privileges that are now yours as a result of his resurrection. But the enemy wants to steal that from you. For the next 5 weeks, we will be going through a series called Identity Theft. that deals precisely with the realities of who you are, who we are in Christ Jesus. Those realities that Satan will want to take away, sniff from you, to nullify in you, to make void in you, so that you cannot achieve this fullness of life that God has already promised you. And listen, this is not something for the future. This is now. This is the here and the now. I get discouraged too. And sometimes I feel like I'm barely alive. But I am going to tell you, I know for a fact that anytime I feel like that, that those are lies from the enemy. Because Jesus did not die so that I could be barely alive. That was just simply not in his plan. If we were to just talk a little bit about how dramatic his resurrection was. Now we have seen this. Hollywood has produced many great movies, and some of them are very accurate to the letter concerning what the scripture says. But even those, there's a little element of the imagination that is left up to us, you know, because the Bible does not describe, you know, facial expressions and thought processes and so on and so forth. So when I imagine the resurrection, when I imagine the death of and the resurrection of Christ, this is how I see it. I see Jesus on the cross, and I see the entire universe, the entire angelic host watching. I see all of the armies of heaven with one hand on the sword and with wings extended, just waiting to come to the rescue, to come and rescue their creator who never utters a single word. Can you imagine having the power to completely undo what these people are doing to you, that you can completely destroy them, that you can completely get yourself out of this painful situation, and yet still choose to stay there because of love? I can only imagine. I can only imagine for a split second when the Father, even the Father, had to turn his face away, causing Jesus to utter the words, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" And then in an instant, it was done. And Jesus uttered those famous words, "It is finished." Not it shall be continued, but it is finished. It is done. I have completed my mission. I can only imagine the silence that overtook heaven. As all of these angelic beings perhaps were in confusion, I don't know. All I know is this. I can only imagine one angel perhaps pacing all night Friday, perhaps asking the Father, "Can I go get him?" And the Father saying, "Not yet. It has not been 3 days." Then pacing all day Saturday, "Can I go get him?" And God saying, "No, not yet." And then early Sunday morning, the Father gets up from his throne and begins to utter the words. And he says, "Okay, now," and before he can even finish, this angel takes off at the speed of light and takes off from heaven on his way to earth. In the book of Matthew, the 28th chapter, we see that the angel arrives at the earth with a great earthquake. The way I see it is that he was flying so fast, he didn't realize how close he was to the earth, and he just slammed against it. And the earth shook. And I can only imagine this angel rolling the stone away as he began to utter the words, "Your Majesty, Your Majesty, your daddy says it's time to get up." Only to find Jesus already sitting down, smiling from ear to ear, saying, "Where you been? I've been up for hours." And he wakes up and he gets out of the tomb. Listen, His resurrection is our resurrection. Not only the resurrection of those who have died physically, but those of us who are dying emotionally, dying spiritually, dying mentally. Jesus is the resurrection, and those who believe in him will not die. And if you have already died, you will come back to life again. He rose with all power in his hands. All power. So he has the power to pick up that which has fallen. He has the power to mend that which was broken. He has the power to restore that which was corroded. He has the power to rebuild that which was destroyed. He has the power to heal that which was wounded. And we know that he can resurrect whatever has died. So this season, I want you to take these words to heart. And I want you to consider whether you are living in the fullness of his resurrection. And perhaps it's an ideal. Perhaps the fullness of his resurrection is so vast we could never fully realize it. But we will be on the right track if we begin to try. So as the worship team comes and sings these words, I want you to meditate on those words, that he is alive. And if he is alive, then so are you. In Jesus' name, amen.
name.